There are many ongoing issues in our country. There is still the ongoing territorial dispute with China in the West Philippine Sea, in which another diplomatic protest was sent to China over the latest incident at the Ayungin Shoal. And this month of June, which is considered by the LGBTQ plus sector as Pride Month, some events were organized within and outside Metro Manila to advocate for the passing of the SOGI Bill. These issues that hides in the agenda of equality will be just using legal power to suppress freedom of those who are against their ideas. Now, these issues concerning sovereignty and legislation clearly demonstrate the detrimental effects on the other parties involved. The coercive actions of China negatively impacted the security of our country, our economy, our environment, and others, while the law that the LGBTQ plus community is advocating has the potential to undermine the free market of ideas in our nation. This is some of the issues that our country are experiencing right now. But there is a community that advances the kingdom of God, which gives total priority to God and His glory, and also characterized by giving priority to others before oneself. And that is the local church, where its members are called to love and serve one another. So this is something that I want us to study this afternoon from our preaching passage. So may I invite you to turn your Bibles with me in the Epistle of Paul to the Galatians, and our preaching will be taken from chapter 5, verses 13 up to verse 15. Once again, Galatians chapter 5, verses 13 to 15. For you were called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. So once again, praise be the Lord upon the reading of His holy word. Now, after the Apostle Paul called the Galatian churches to action by not living under the slavery of the law, which we can find in chapter 4, verse 12, from the words of the Apostle Paul, I entreat you. And this formally begins the request section of this epistle. Because not only that the right standing with God only comes by faith rather than the works of the law, but we should understand that those who strive to be righteous through the works of the law will be judged by God. That's why there is this calling of the Apostle Paul to live not under the slavery of the law. But Paul also worries that the Galatians will revert back to their pagan practices and old ways of life. This was a province of Roman Empire in which many local churches were established. That's why in the first chapter of this epistle, the Apostle Paul addressed to the churches of Galatia. So in this section in which our passage belongs, the Apostle Paul continues to call these Galatian churches into action, but this time against libertinism. Paul not only corrected those who wanted to be righteous to God by their works, but also those who use God's grace as an excuse for licentious living, because the grace of salvation does not mean exemption from obedience to God and to the duty to follow His commandments from His Word. So we must not only avoid being unresponsive to the gospel. God commanded every sinners who heard the blessed message of salvation about the Lord Jesus Christ to repent and believe the gospel. But at the same time, those who professed salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ must not live like the world. Because freedom from salvation produces a kind of life that seeks to be faithful to God. And that's the calling of the Apostle Paul. In our passage, you were called to freedom. There is this freedom from the slavery of the law to the kind of freedom that totally devoted to God. That's the freedom that the Apostle Paul is espousing in the later commands that he will show in this passage. And one of the purposes of this freedom is for Christians to truly serve one another. Paul commanded in verse 13, "But through love, serve one another." The command to serve in our passage has a meaning of becoming a slave. It has the imagery opposite to a master who have many slaves, because the imagery in this command of the Apostle Paul is a slave who have many masters. Therefore, Christian freedom must be realized by becoming slaves of love, because it liberates us from our natural desire for self-centeredness, and it enables us to find the joy in serving others. So let us become willing slaves of this command of God, because this is our perfect freedom. Neglecting this duty reveals the kind of life that is enslaved by our natural desire. We are not living according to the will of God, according to His words, but rather we are living according to our own ways. And let us not also fall into the wrong practices of serving, because this should be done in genuine love. This instruction will keep us from abusing our ministries or falling into a kind of service that seeks only our own personal interests. That's why from this passage, let me give you the message. Loving service to others is a practice of perfect freedom commanded by God for every Christian. Once again, loving service to others is a practice of perfect freedom commanded by God for every Christian. This is because our life must be under complete submission to God, and our specific application should be guided by either the direct teachings of the Word or its general principles. That's the case of this duty of serving others. This is a command of God, thus says the Lord. But its application also must be directed by God Himself. This must be conducted through love. And for the Apostle Paul, it has a basis. That's what he said in verse 14. Fulfillment of the law. Though the law is not a means for salvation, but for those who are with right standing with God, we should biblically apply the law in our lives. Jesus Himself in the New Testament summarized the requirements of the law towards others by His words, loving your neighbors as yourself. There is the law of God that requires us to conduct our duties with love towards others. which we can fulfill by loving service to our brethren. Therefore, we should not remain neglectful or in the wrong applications of service. Instead, we should strive to be faithful, to cultivate this Christian duty. Because for the Apostle Paul, it has advantages in our life of faith that we can learn from these truths. First, it mortifies sinful desires. Once again, it mortifies sinful desires. Because there is a prohibition given by the Apostle Paul before he commanded the duty of loving service to our brethren. And that's what we can see in verse 13. Only do not use your freedom as opportunity for the flesh. The life that is free from salvation through works must not be spent in sinful ways, according to the Apostle Paul. Because the word flesh refers to the existence outside salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, the unconverted people are living in indulgence to sin. Paul forbids this corrupted way of life, but he also gives a positive command of loving service to others as its counterpart. Therefore, you have here a prohibition of the Apostle Paul at the same time his positive command to love one another by the application of service. Because fulfilling the duty of loving service to others can subdue our temptations for sinful desire. That's a wisdom from the Word. Because in the New Testament teaching, the present world is in the period of tension between this age and age to come in the history of salvation. Therefore, there are still limitations to falling into sinful ways. This is still a course of this present world because the perfection of salvation is yet to come. Therefore, genuine believers can still have sins, even though we are presently in Christ. So we must carry out the duties against sin, like rejecting to commit sins while cultivating the opposite grace for the life of holiness. And we must carry out these duties against sin by completely relying on God, not on our own strength or our own ability. And part of these duties against sin is the command of the Apostle Paul, loving service to others, which we must apply in total reliance to God. Christians must resist temptations of sinning while cultivating the grace of love and applying it to the opportunities of serving others. Because if we spend our time, our strength in loving service, especially to our brethren, there cannot be time for sinful thoughts. There cannot be strength for sinful actions. That's why the discipline of obeying God's will, despite the opposite desire, will train us to resist yielding if the desires are sinful. And faithful observance of God's commands, like loving service, will make us learn the joy, the contentment of living under the perfect will of our God. But without observing this duty of loving service to others, many professors of faith become prone to the opportunities of the flesh. In history, until the Middle Ages, swords were the primary weapons for combat warfare. This was before the significant development of firearms. During the Renaissance period, the gun technology. So for a skilled soldier, there was a demand for preparedness in facing any battle represented by his sharp sword. But this act of sharpening the sword requires discipline, because rather than relaxing or enjoying a peaceful day, the soldier understands that this unpleasant duty is important for preparation against any potential dangers. In earlier periods, this process was more laborious, until the development of stations for sharpening tools, or the soldier might just carry sharpening objects like small grindstones. Now, if a soldier is engaged in a disciplined action to prepare for a physical warfare, we must also engage in the application of this unpleasant duty of serving one another, because we have this more important battle for holiness. That's why, though this application is unpleasant to our natural desires, we must acknowledge that it yields advantages for our battle against sins. That's why, beware of idleness in serving our brethren, because of the danger of living in our own sinful ways. Beware of this. Idleness in this duty is part of neglecting the command of God, which is for all believers and not only for a select few. There can be personal or public kind of service for our brethren, for us to have plenty of opportunities to serve. Therefore, let us not wrongly judge one another in this matter, because we can serve even in private. However, let us not contrast private and public services that we can do for others, for these complements, these are not contradictory. We do not only have roles in our private homes. Men and women also have roles in the church that we can find in the New Testament. And also we have this duty of stewardship of God's gifts to us to function for the benefit of the whole congregation. So we must be faithful stewards of our gifts. Our services must be conducted out of love, for us to be faithful in every opportunity to serve, especially our brethren, whether in secret or in spotlight. So let us search ourselves. Are we lovingly serving our brethren? Is it our desire? Is it our prayers? Are we taking opportunities to serve? May we not fall into idleness in loving service to our brethren, because God commanded us to serve those whom He redeemed by the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Unfaithfulness to fulfill this duty will not only fail to do good to others, but will also brings failure in our dealings against sins. For serving has always had its connection to and demand for holiness. This is a wisdom against sin. The first great awakening preacher along with Jonathan Edwards was George Whitefield. He was known in history for his zeal in spreading the gospel to the ends of the world. He preached almost 30,000 sermons in his 34 years of ministry. He crossed the Atlantic Ocean 13 times, which made him spend almost 3 years of his life on a ship. And it is believed that he preached to 10 million people during his ministry, an almost impossibility during their time. However, it is crucial to understand that his ministry is inseparable from his pursuit of holiness. This is something that we should understand in the ministry of this man. J.C. Ryle, the author of the well-known book, Holiness, deeply admired George Whitefield. He said about Whitefield, "I believe no English preacher has ever possessed such a combination of excellent qualifications as Whitefield. In my opinion, he stands alone." This is J.C. Ryle. This was because Whitefield understood that his dedication to his demanding ministry must lead him to recognize his greater need for holiness. In one of his sermons, he said, "Abhor thy sinful course of life and serve God in holiness and righteousness all the remaining part of life." And he walked his talk. For Christian, holiness is not separated but demanded, even in the duty of service, which includes loving service to our brethren. That's why it mortifies sinful desires. But another thing, it mortifies hating others. Because Paul also shows the contrast to his command of loving service to others. Verse 15 has these nouns in Greek: bite, devour, consumed. In their time, people frequently use these words to describe wild animals engaged in deadly struggles. Because for the Apostle Paul, the life that is free from salvation through the works of the law must not also be spent in fierce criticism and hatred towards others. This must not be our life if we are believers. Paul raised awareness about the social conflicts among the churches in Galatia that broke their fellowship and their unity from his command. Watch out. There must be prevention of hating one another. But for the Apostle Paul, while observing his previous command of loving service to one another. Because fulfilling the duty of loving service can keep Christians from harboring hatred towards others. This is what biblical servanthood is doing in our lives as God's people. For hating others is an attitude that comes from sinful enslavement to self. This attitude opposes God. This attitude opposes the Word. Because for Christians, we are called not to take advantage of others or not to seek to destroy others. Because we are even called to love our enemy. So our desire will be for the good of others, either from our words, by speaking the truth in love, or by our works, by serving others out of genuine love. This is another wisdom of servanthood. Therefore, our loving service to others must not be hindered by disappointments or offenses against us by our brethren. Because this duty of service encourages graciousness, encourages forgiving attitude, for we serve out of genuine love. We are not strangers to love. That's why there's that condition, love your neighbor as yourself. For we are not strangers of love, because we love ourselves. What we should do is to direct that love to others. And if we are believers, we knew the love of God in the Lord Jesus Christ that calls us to love our brethren. The Apostle John in 1 John chapter 4, verse 11, after he described the love of God in the Lord Jesus Christ, this is his command: if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another, which we can apply in loving service to our brethren. This is specific. For loving service and hatred cannot coexist in one person at the same time, as either our hatred will prevent us from serving or our love will cause us to mortify any forms of hatred in our hearts. There are things in the world that naturally don't go together, like oil and water. This is due to the distinct molecular structures of these substances. So when combining water with oil, even if we mix them together, the water molecules will just clump together to each other. The same goes with the oil, forming the denser water at the bottom, while oil, which has less density, will occupy the top layer. If there are these substances that cannot coexist together, how much more the opposite characteristics of sinful hatred and loving service? The people of the world who hate God will hate God's people. That's why they cannot serve out of genuine love. But the people of God who love God Himself will going to love His people, therefore will not harbor sinful hatred. That's why let us apply this attitude in service. From this specific challenge, persevere in loving service to others despite their wrongdoings. this is an act of love. Fulfillment of the command of God must not be hindered by actions of men. We cannot excuse our disobedience by what others have done. We cannot do that. And we have the biblical motivation of love in serving. So we will not look others in terms of how they can serve us, or look others in terms of how they treated us, but to look to others by that intentional resolve to serve the brethren. This is an act of love. And continuing in this biblical duty can be instrument in the hands of God to lead those erring brethren towards repentance, for we repay their evil by good. But being realistic, there are also joys in service, joys and encouraging period in the ministry for us to really serve one another. But remember, if we are in a challenging period of service for whatever reason or because of what others are doing, let us not forget this wisdom: persevere until the end. This should be an application in the church life of genuine churches of the Lord Jesus Christ. For the application of right service has advantages to our life of faith, like progress in sanctification. This duty mortifies sinful hate. And a while ago we heard, this duty mortifies sinful desires. So let us apply the instructions of the Word towards biblical application of service. And let us appreciate the design of God to the local church to serve one another. For this will sanctify us, not only as individual disciples, but also corporately as a church. For as long as there are instructions about service founded in the gospel and venues to serve one another in the local church, that church will continue to grow in holiness, will continue to deepen their fellowship and their unity with one another. The reformer Martin Luther, who was also known for his biblical doctrine of good works, always insisted this phrase during his time, that a living faith expresses itself in works of love. Part of his basis for this doctrine is our preaching text. For this portion of passage also belongs to his own commentary on Galatians, with a heading from Martin Luther, The Doctrine of Good Works. And from this portion of his commentary, Martin Luther provided guidance for Christians on how to serve others, both in general and among our fellow members in the local church in particular. Let me read some of his words. Luther wrote, "The apostle encumbers them with the rule of mutual love, so that they should serve each other in love. My neighbor is every person, especially those who need my help. Even if a person has done me some wrong or has hurt me in any way, he is still a human being with flesh and blood. As long as a person remains a human being, so long is he to be an object of our love. For the avoidance of discord in the church, diverse opinions, dissensions, one member bites and devours the other, condemns each other until they are consumed. Paul lays down the principle, let everybody serve in love. This is the Apostle Paul. For genuine love makes those who truly serve to abhor any form of hatred towards a brethren. So there are spiritual benefits to live out the perfect freedom in the Christian life, like loving service. So let us take every opportunity as privilege to serve one another. But let me also remind our friends, visitors, and children who are apart from God's saving grace, because serving others is not the gospel. Serving others is not a substitute for understanding and responding by faith to the saving message of the gospel. For no amount of service can answer our eternal judgment from God. So do not ignore this warning, and do not put your hope in wrong alternatives for forgiveness of sins, like religion and good work. For there is a reminder of the Apostle Paul in our passage, do not live under the slavery of the law, for good works are not answer for our salvation, because God Himself provided. Yahweh Yireh, God Himself sent His beloved Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and resurrected from the dead. May you respond to this message of salvation by repenting of your sins and believing the one who came not to be served, but to serve, and gave His life as a ransom for many. Let's close in prayer. Our gracious God and our Heavenly Father, once again, we thank You for the reminder of Your word, for our life of faith is not separated from our calling of loving service to one another, and we confess our limitations in this duty, for our minds are dull, our hearts are cold, and oftentimes this duty is unpleasant to us, but we thank You for Your word is indeed wisdom, for there are many encouragements for us to serve one another, like what we heard. It mortifies both sinful desires and hatred towards others. That's why help us, O Lord, to truly serve and persevere in this calling until the end, and bless our life of faith, not only as individual Christians, but also corporately as a church. Make Your church grow in holiness, grow in unity and fellowship. with one another, and we also commit to you that may you bless also our hearts to all the things that we had heard this day, both in the study of your doctrine this morning and the morning preaching of your word, that all of these things may indeed have applications in our life. Help us not only to hear your word, but indeed to be doers of it. For we commit all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.